Welcome to another night of prayer meeting at Windsor Pentecostal Church. Join us in worship and praise and prayer.
Paid in full by the blood of the Lamb, free from sin.
Wonderful he is.
Wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. Counselor, Prince of Peace, mighty God is he. Saving me, keeping me from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise his name. Saving me, keeping me from all sin and shame.
Hallelujah. On my best day, I'll take Jesus. On my worst day, I'll take Jesus. On any day, I'll take Jesus. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
As they gamble for the robe he wore, they choose a worldly trade. They didn't think of eternity as the soldiers drove the nails. Will we learn from what they done or make the same mistake? Jesus, oh, the world, my child, which one will you? I'll take Jesus. I'll take Jesus. I try those worldly pleasures and they fade. When you see the gates of heaven and hear the Master say, me, oh, the world, my child, which one did you take? When the pages of my life have turned and time has rolled away, deeds that I have done won't help me on that day, and all my earthly treasures that I have laid away, they'll be for me just a memory. And this you hear me say, yeah. I'll take Jesus. I try those worldly pleasures and they fade. When you see the gates of heaven and you hear the Master say, which one did you take? I'll take Jesus. I'll take Jesus. I try those worldly pleasures and they fail. When you see the gates of heaven and you hear the Master say, me, oh, the world, my child, which one did you take? Me, oh, the world, my child, which one? Thank you.
important message. What an important choice to choose between life and death, between heaven and hell, between Jesus and the minions of the dark place. Jesus is so precious.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me to stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storms, through the night, lead me on to your light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me on. When the darkness appears and the night draws near and the day is past and gone, at the river I stand, guide my feet, please hold my hand, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me on. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me on to you.
Thank you so much, Lauren, for leading us in that time of worship this evening. That was beautiful. After our Bible study this evening, we'll be having a time of prayer, and we'll be bringing your needs to the Lord. We're continuing a series of Bible studies that we started several weeks ago as pastors, and it's based on a book by John Maxwell, Running with the Giants. And it's based on Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1, which says, "Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses," people that are cheering us on, "let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." The previous chapter, chapter 11, lists a number of Old Testament saints who are known for their great faith. Last week, Pastor Jeff looked at Jonathan, the son of King Saul, and he showed us how Jonathan, through his leadership and ministry, helped save a nation. For the next few moments tonight, we're going to look at another hero of the faith, and that is Nehemiah. Who is Nehemiah? Nehemiah was a young Jewish boy, probably from the tribe of Judah, formerly from the city of Jerusalem. He entered the king's courts as a young boy, and he became a cupbearer. Now, a cupbearer was a very important person to the king of Persia. It was the person that would guard the feeding, the meals, and especially the wine. And sometimes he would test that wine and make sure there was no poison or anything. People were trying to kill the king. So he was had a very influential position in the kingdom. And the Bible says that when he was in this position, his brother came from Jerusalem, and it was in the autumn. And he shared with them the condition of Jerusalem, what was going on there. The sin was rampant there. The walls were down, and the gates were burned, and the city was in destruction. So the Bible says that he sat down and he wept. He wept over the city of Jerusalem. Reminds me when Jesus was coming into the city of Jerusalem, the Bible says that he wept when he saw that city. And for days, the Bible says that he mourned and he fasted and he prayed to God, to the God of heaven. And one day in the spring, this was in the autumn, and in the spring of the year when he was serving the king. And the Bible says that he never appeared sad before the king. He always had joy and happiness. But this day he served the king and he was sad because he was sad for his city, the destruction of his city. And the king noticed Nehemiah, and he asked him, and he said, "Why are you sad?" Nehemiah explained the condition of his city, his father's city, his ancestor's city, his ancestors that were buried there. And in Nehemiah chapter 2 and verse 3, it says, "For the city where my ancestors are buried are in ruin, and the gates have been destroyed by fire." Then the king said, "How can I help?" Well, Nehemiah had been praying and he had been fasting that God, that you would make a way for me to go back to my city. And this is what happened. He had such favor with the king, and the king granted him permission to go back to Jerusalem. Not only did he grant him permission to go back to Jerusalem, but he gave him protection. He gave him letters of endorsement. He gave him materials that he needed to rebuild that city. And he became the governor of Judah. So he went from a boy in the courtroom to a cupbearer, and now the governor of Judah. And he went back and he finished those walls in 52 days. Wow. Now that's a miracle. Now I want to listen to what Nehemiah has to say as we're running around that track. He's coming by and he's going to share something with me. Probably one of the first things he would say is, "No problem is too big when you have help. When you have help, that problem is not big. You can't do it on your own." He asked the king for help. The rebuilding of the walls of Jerusalem is not a story of a single successful person. When he told them, he said, "Let us rise and build." They came together and they built that wall. We have to ask for help. There are so many gifted people in our church. And from his book, I'm going to share five situations where we should ask for help. What are one of the obstacles why we don't ask for help? I know us men, we're notorious for not asking for help or directions when we need it. But I believe that one of the biggest obstacles in asking for help is pride. Pride, that we have pride that we can do. We don't need help. And the other thing I believe is fear. Fear of rejection, fear that that person may not help. So number one, we should ask for help when the problem is bigger than us. Let me repeat that. We should ask for help when the problem is bigger than us. If you had any problems, are you going through a problem in your family, in your life right now that's bigger than you? Maybe it's time that you should ask for help. Nehemiah's problem was bigger than he was. He was more than a thousand miles away from that city. And the people of Jerusalem, they had no materials to build that wall. The people were discouraged. And they had no will to enter this project. And there was great opposition from their neighboring enemies. When you and I face problems that are bigger than us, it's not a time to get discouraged. It's a time to get help. Get help. Text someone, call someone, ask for help. Us as men, as I say, we are the worst. Number two, we should ask for help from others when the problem gets personal. When there's a personal problem that we need help, then we should ask. Nehemiah heard about the problem and he mourned for a day. There was a personal problem. There was a personal connection with Jerusalem. It was the home of his family, his forefathers. His father grew up there and it became a personal problem. So we should ask for help when the problem becomes personal. Number three, we should ask others for help when we have shared the problem with God, when we have prayed about the problem, when we have sought God and for the answer. The first thing Nehemiah did when he heard about the problem was pray. The first thing he did, he got on his knees and he prayed and he wept and he mourned for the city of Jerusalem. One of our church family members here this week, their father passed away and went home to be with the Lord. And I've been listening to some of his stories of answered prayer. Our late Harvey Noserty lost his dad when he was just a little boy. And he tells the story of his mother and how they had no food. And she had a big family and she was raising as a single mom. And she would go and she would set that table and ask the children to sit around, and they would say, "Mom, we've got no food." And that's okay. She would go away, and she would pray, and she would remind God, and said, "God, you said you would never leave us nor forsake us, and that you would supply the need and come back, and God would supply that need." He tells the story about Harry himself, when he was working with the A&D company in the woods, and there was a big fire that was coming their way, and they had all this wood piled up, and they knew that this wood would be destroyed, and he was hesitant in putting down his saw and leaving, but before he left, he put his hand up to God and prayed and said, "God, you said in your word," he reminded God of his word, "that a man is worthy of his hire. And these people have worked hard for that." And they went away. And when the fire had gone through, they went back. And there was fire up this way, down that way, across that way. But that wood was there. It was still there. He tells the story of his mom that she would make garments, but God would send the buyer. God was faithful. There's a great hymn of the church. "Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer." What a wonderful hymn of the church. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4 and 16, "Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace in our time of need." I believe that verse is for someone listening tonight, or someone that may be listening days or weeks or years if the Lord should tarry. And I'm going to repeat that verse again. "Let us therefore come boldly," not timidly, not shy, but boldly, "into the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace in our time of need." What is your time of need tonight? What is your, maybe this is the time that you need to come boldly before the throne room of God and remind him of his promises. He said he would never leave the righteous forsaken. God wants to be our partner throughout life. Too often we are tempted to carry the load ourselves. Sometimes he moves before us. Sometimes he moves after us, but he never moves without us. That's how he moves. Without God, we cannot. And without us, God will not. He will not. He needs us. Nehemiah was willing to go halfway across the known world at that time and to do what he could do. And so should you and I. Maybe not go halfway around the world, but let us do what we can do. Let us make the garments, and God will bring the buyers, and God will do the rest. Number five, finally, tonight, the last point. We should ask others for help when we sense God's approval for the vision. We should ask others for help when we know that what God has placed in our hearts is from God. It's a vision from God. Nehemiah said that when the king gave him permission to go to Jerusalem, he sent supplies and letters and material. This is what the Bible says, Nehemiah 2 and 8. The king granted me according to the good hand of God upon me. The presence of God was upon Jeremiah, and the hand of God was upon him. When Nehemiah stood before the people of Jerusalem, when he went back there to challenge them to rebuild the wall, he said in Nehemiah 2 and 8, the hand of my God, which has been upon me, letting the people know that God was leading. This was not just a good idea, this was a God idea. He sensed God's approval on the project, so he asked for help. There were so many skilled people there to help him build that wall. And they did it in 52 days. That's incredible. And they dedicated that wall to the Lord. So this evening, what would Nehemiah's final words of encouragement be to you and I? He would say, it isn't easy to ask for help, but it's necessary. Don't let insecurity or ego or fear make you try to go it alone and do it yourself. Don't let insecurity, don't let ego, don't let fear get in the way. Don't let pride get in the way. In God's kingdom, there are people ready to help you at the right time, at the right place, and bring the right thing to the table that's needed in your situation tonight. Many times, we don't need a miracle. We need each other. We need each other, and that's a miracle. God has already provided everything that we need. He would say, my friend, you can run this race well, but you can't run it alone. This is a race. You need people with you. It's not a one-man show. Tonight, as one of your pastors, along with Pastor Jeff and Pastor Andy, we cannot do this alone. We need you. I know things are different now. They're through this COVID pandemic. I know that. But you know what? This place will be open again if the Lord tarries, if the rapture is not taking place. This place will open again, and we will see these pews filled. Number one, what do we need tonight, this time, in this situation, in our province, in our country, and in the world? We need you to pray. We need prayer more than we've ever needed prayer before. It's the brick and the mortar that we need to build this wall. Then we need you to help us when the time comes. We're having our drive-in services now. We've got volunteers coming and helping. And God, and we need that. And we're blessed with that. All of the skills that we need to run this drive-in service that we have Sunday nights, if the weather permits. We need you. And we need you to show the love of Jesus in this community, in your family, in our families, We need you to show the love of Christ. When people are getting impatient and people are getting upset and short-tempered, we need cool minds. We need to be patient, and we need to show the love of Jesus. We're going to for a time of prayer this evening. And I know there are many needs in our assembly. I'm not going to name the needs, but we've got needs for salvation in families. And there may be tonight, there may be family members that probably wouldn't come on a Tuesday night or not even on a Sunday morning, but you're listening. You're listening tonight or today, whenever it is that you're listening. And you're not saved. You don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. But somebody's been praying for you. Mom and Dad and Grandma's been praying for you. It's been a personal thing for them. And maybe tonight you want to say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Save me. Forgive me of my sins. That's all you need to do tonight. In the quietness of your room, where you are right now, ask Jesus to come into your heart and save your soul. Your need tonight may be physical. You may be suffering some physical ailment tonight. Your body may be riddled with pain. My God is here tonight, and the presence of the Lord is here to touch you, to heal you, to meet that physical need tonight. We're going to pray for that. Pray for that. It may be arthritis, it may be back pain, it may be cancer, it may be heart trouble, it may be kidney trouble, it may be migraine headaches, arthritis. Whatever your need is tonight, God is here to meet that need, that physical need. That need may be emotional. You may be going through some depression, and you don't understand what's going on, but God is here to touch you tonight. Pray that God will heal you. It may be the loss of a loved one. We've got several families that have lost loved ones this week. So pray for those families. And that your need tonight may be relational. There may be some relationship that's starting to deteriorate. Maybe you're right in the midst of a divorce right now. But God can change that. God can change that around. I'm going to pray for that relationship tonight. So let's bow in prayer. Father, we come to you tonight, Lord Jesus. And God, you see every need that's represented in every home and on every computer right now, Lord. You see the need in that family. I pray for that physical need, God. Oh, Father, tonight, Lord, I pray that your healing touch would be upon that person, that they would sense right now, as I sense right now, the anointing of your Holy Spirit, God, that you would touch them, that you would heal them from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. Lord, right now, I pray that you would touch their bodies. Lord, that you would rid their bodies of this pain, of this cancer, of this ailment, God, of this sickness, Lord. Let your healing virtue flow, God, right now in the name of Jesus. God, for that person that's experiencing emotional problems, maybe discouragement, maybe depression tonight, Lord, I pray, Father, Lord, that you would touch them, God, that your healing virtue would flow through their bodies and their minds, Lord, right now in Jesus' name. God, if that need tonight, Father, is relationships. Maybe it's a relationship between a son and a father. Maybe it's a husband and wife. Maybe it's between a family member. Maybe there's something that's gotten between you. And I pray tonight, Lord, that you would heal that relationship, God. And God, that you would mend that family and bring them back together, Lord. And Father, I pray, Lord, tonight, God, that each one that's listening to this message tonight, God, Lord, that have listened to this worship, listened to this time in the Word, God, Lord, that they would be encouraged, and God, that you have brought forth a word tonight from this mouthpiece here, Lord, to that ear, God, that they need you tonight, Lord. Touch them in Jesus' wonderful name. I want to encourage you to just spend at least 15 minutes or 10 or 15 minutes after you hear this teaching tonight, to get alone with the Lord and ask the Lord. Maybe it's to go to another room. Maybe it's to take a walk. Maybe it's to just go out in the yard, but ask the Lord and pray to the Lord and seek the Lord. Seek the Lord tonight and ask. And then ask people. Whatever your need is, ask people. God uses people. God uses us. Don't miss this coming Sunday at 11. We have another broadcast coming to you over the internet. And also our 6 p.m. has been changed to 6 p.m., our drive-in service here at the parking lot at Windsor Pentecostal Church. Pastor Jeff will be bringing a wonderful message in both services. You don't want to miss those messages. And invite a friend. Come out in the parking lot. Last week we had over 180 cars come. So be here. The gate is open at 5 o'clock now. It used to be 5:30, so it's open at 5 for the 6 o'clock service. My prayer tonight is that you would be encouraged as you go forward, as you seek the Lord, as you reach out, as you ask others to come along with you. It's not a journey that we need to be on alone, because God has supplied someone. I pray that you would be encouraged tonight and have a blessed week. God bless.